Okay. So now let us focus on that subclass of systems that are both linear as well as time invariant. So this is a very, very important subclass, and they are abbreviated as LTI or LSI, linear time invariant or linear shift invariant. And the number of very useful and practical systems can indeed be modeled as LTI. And you will see that there is a very powerful theory associated with LTI systems. Mathematically it is very much tractable, but if that mathematical tractability alone were the criterion, this would not be as useful. Okay, it is mathematically tractable, so what? The fact that many practical systems can be modeled as LTI systems is the key point. So you have the advantage of mathematical tractability plus it being practical for a wide number of cases. So LTI system must satisfy superposition and time invariance. And we will further assume that this is true for infinite linear combinations as well. So the very starting point of LTI theory is as follows. So recall the sifting property of the unit impulse, x of n times delta of n minus k is, it picks out the kth sample. Delta of n minus k is located at the kth index, it picks out that particular sample. And any signal can be expressed as a linear combination of scaled and delayed impulses. So this is x of n times delta of n, it picks out x of 0. This is x of n times delta of n minus 1, it picks out x of 1, all the other samples are 0. Similarly, this is x of n times delta of n plus 2, picks out the sample at minus 2. So if you consider x of n times delta of n plus x of n times delta of n minus 1 and x of n times delta of n plus 2, then these products pick out the individual samples at those locations. And in general, if you have an arbitrary sequence, if you focus on x of k times delta of n minus k, so here you have an impulse at the kth location, very easy to see that an arbitrary sequence can be thought of as sum of scaled and delayed impulses. Therefore, if you let k go from minus infinity to plus infinity, that is another way of thinking of the arbitrary input x of n. So in general, this is an infinite linear combination of scaled and delayed impulses. So this brings us to the impulse response. Arbitrary input, if the input is x of n, for an LTI system the output is y of n. If the input happens to be delta of n, it has a special name and it is usually denoted by h of n. In continuous time system, this was denoted by h of t, and this is called as the impulse response. All right. So this impulse response plays a central role in LTI systems theory. So if you have knowledge of h of n, you will find that you can get the output to any input x of n. And the fact that you are able to find the output to any input x of n follows from both linearity being true as well as time invariance. So delta of n produces h of n, delta of n minus k produces h of n minus k. This is of course time invariance. X of k times delta of n minus k producing x of k times h of n minus k is homogeneity. And if you sum up over all k, x of k delta of n minus k, then you get x of k times h of n minus k summed up over all k. So this is additivity, but here we are using additivity for infinite number of terms which we have assumed it is true. But x of k times delta of n minus k summed up over all k is nothing but x of n. Therefore, for an arbitrary input x of n, when applied to an LTI system, you will get this as the output. So x of n producing y of n, and y of n is indeed this, is the well known famous convolution result. So this is called as the convolution sum. The corresponding counterpart for CT systems is the convolution integral, and this is very central to LTI systems theory. right, and this is denoted as x of n star h of n. So, this stands for the convolution, and this is the counterpart for the continuous time case, and it is denoted as x of t star h of t. If you write it as x star h, this notation is used for both ct as well as dt convolution. Since convolution involves summation or integration, it is a smoothing operation. So, later I will show a Java applet that brings this point clearly. So, this star is just notation, it should not be misinterpreted. So, if x of t convolved with h of t is y of t, right? Let us go back to this. So, x of t is say x of t times h of t. What is y of ct? This is x of ct times h of ct. So, this is very clear. Now, let us look at this. Y of t is x of t star h of t. This does not mean y of ct is x of ct star h of ct. All right. But what is true is if you write down the actual convolution integral definition. So, y of t was minus infinity to plus infinity x of tau h of t minus tau d tau. There if I replace t by ct, on the right hand side also I can replace t by c times t. Whereas, this is not true because star is just notation. The correct answer is y of ct equals, actually there is a slight error here, I have not fixed this error. It is not actually c, okay. I want you to find out what the error is. Mod c, very good. Yeah, you already seen this before. Then c is actually mod c. So, verify that y of ct is indeed mod c times x of tt convolved with h of ct. So, similar remarks apply to the dt case, except that there are slight differences in the way scaling works for ct versus dt. And maths textbooks usually use this notation for convolution. Again, this is all review, let me quickly go through this. This is continuous time convolution, replace the independent variable t by tau. Because you want the final answer to be in terms of t, so you change the dummy x to from t to tau. This remains fixed, this gets flipped, h of tau becomes h of minus tau, and then you shift the flipped signal by t naught units. So, if w of tau is h of minus tau, then you need to look at w of tau minus t naught, because you are going to shift the flipped signal. So, wherever tau is there, replace tau by tau minus t naught. So, since w of tau is h of minus tau, replace tau alone by tau minus t naught and you get h of t naught minus tau. Then you multiply point by point and then integrate over the entire range where t naught is arbitrary. Remember, t naught is the shift, and since this is an arbitrary shift, you need to test for all possible shifts, and all possible shifts means shifting the entire signal from minus infinity to plus infinity. So, replace t naught by the general t. Now, t has to take the value between minus infinity to plus infinity. So, the corresponding discrete time is identical. Replace n by k, because we want the final answer to be in terms of n. Keep one signal fixed, flip the other, shift the flipped signal, multiply point by point and sum up, and you get the usual convolution sum. If you understand convolution in the continuous time domain, then convolution in the discrete time is no different. And some of the points related to convolution I want to show with respect to the Java applet. which I will do next class. And an arbitrary sequence can be expressed as a sum of scaled and delayed impulses is what we saw, and this is exactly the form of a convolution sum. So this is exactly in the form of x of n convolved with delta of n. Therefore, this is an important identity. Convolution with impulse leaves the signal unchanged. Similarly, in the continuous time case, x of t convolved with delta of t, you get back the original signal. And here is an important identity. If you take x of n and convolve it with delta of n minus n naught, you shift the input by the shift of the impulse. So let us go through this step by step. Replace n by k. So n minus n naught becomes k minus n naught, or wherever n was, replace n by k. Then flip, wherever k is there, replace k by minus k. And then replace k by k minus n to account for the shift by n unit. So wherever k alone is there, replace k by k minus n. So you get delta of n minus n naught minus k. And then you multiply point by point and then sum up over all possible indices. And here the only term that will survive is when k equals n minus n naught. For everywhere else, this is going to be 0. Therefore, you get this. And hence, x of n convolved with delta of n minus n naught is indeed x of n minus n naught. If you are not careful, you will make mistakes in how you reflect and how you shift. Right? So, this is where some of the errors can occur if you are not careful. Therefore, x of n convolved with delta of n minus n naught is indeed x of n minus n naught. The corresponding continuous time counterpart, of course, is very similar. And you should have already by now seen the difference between convolution and sifting. Convolution is x of n convolved in delta of n minus n naught is x of n minus n naught. This is the continuous time counterpart. Whereas sifting, you take x of n multiply by delta of n minus n naught. It picks out the sample at n naught and the delta still remains, because the product has to be 0 outside whenever the index is not n naught. Okay, so notice carefully the difference between these two cases. And these are examples. Again, I will expand upon these examples later. You must have seen this in your earlier course. And again, if both signals are causal, then you can think of causal signals as the term we are using, causality. Earlier we had used the term causal for systems. Right, here we are borrowing that term, and we use the term the signal is causal if it is 0 for t less than 0. So if you have both x and h, if they are 0 for t less than 0, you can replace x with x times u of t, h of t by h of t times u of t, where u of t of course is the unit step function. And then you can simplify the limits of the convolution integral like this. So replace x of tau by x of tau times u of tau, similarly for h of t minus tau. And then if you look at the product u of tau, u of t minus tau, this is u of tau and this is u of t minus tau. So the product exists only from 0 to t, and everywhere else the product is 0, which means you can now change the limits from minus infinity to plus infinity to 0 to t. So when the signal is 0 for t less than 0, you can make this change in the limit. Now, similarly, the discrete time summation also can be simplified from minus infinity to plus infinity. The summation will collapse to 0 to little n when both x of n and h of n are causal, namely they are 0 for n less than 0. And these are some simple convolution exercises that you can try. And this is an important property. If x of t is 0 outside a1 and b1, and if h of t is 0 outside a2 to b2, then you can show that the convolution result is 0 outside a1 plus a2 to b1 plus b2. You can reason this out very similar to what was done for the case of causal signals. So these are important exercises. They have discrete time counterparts as well, where you take one signal that is causal and the other signal is non-causal. So this is 0 for t less than 0, whereas this is 0 for t greater than 0. How you are able to simplify this step by step is important. Only then you are fully understood. You may understand graphically convolution very well, but you should also be able to write down the equations, fix the limits, simplify and get the final expression that is correct. So, only if you are able to do that, you have completely understood all the individual parts.